everybody. Today we're going to discuss a little bit about evolution and also a little bit about Charles Darwin and some of his ideas and the proof that we have to show that evolution is, in fact, happening. So, simply put, evolution is gradual change or diversification of a population over several generations. A very important thing to remember is that individuals don't evolve. Populations or groups of individuals evolve over time, but the individuals themselves don't change their genetic makeup. So there are four major mechanisms of evolution, and we call these mechanisms of change, and they are mutations, migrations, genetic drift, and natural selection. And we're going to go through all of these and understand how it is that each of these different things could change the number of genetic variations in a population. So let's imagine that we're looking at this moth right here, and that normally it has very light colored wings. So its wings are sort of an off-white color. But let's imagine that there is a mutation in its DNA that just arises by mistake. So it might be a frameshift mutation or a point mutation. But let's imagine that this mutation caused the butterfly's wings to change color. So now the butterfly has different colored wings than it originally had. Now it has very dark colored wings. So now just by random chance, we have a different number of dark moths than we had originally. Originally we didn't have any, and now we have a couple. Okay, so now let's talk about migration. So for this example, we're going to imagine that over here on the left, so right here, we have an island that has a population of the light-colored moths, and it's separated from the mainland by a really large body of water. So normally there aren't any other moths that live on this island. But let's imagine that we have a really big hurricane that comes through, and it blows a bunch of these moths over here over onto the island, and so now you have changed the frequency of dark moths due to migration, or species moving from a different place. So now, even though no genetic mutation had occurred to cause the white moth to become a dark moth, we had new ones that came in for whatever reason from a different place. So that changed the frequency of the dark moths versus the white moths. So for genetic drift, I think I'm going to need a little bit more room here, because we're going to start off with a population that has equal numbers of dark and light moths. So one of the unfortunate things that then happens to this population of moths is that somebody accidentally steps on two of these moths right here, and so neither of them survives long enough to reproduce. There is one white moth who survives long enough to reproduce, and it produces two offspring, so like this. And then each of these two, or excuse me, these three dark moths each produce two offspring. And so now we have two white moths and six dark moths. And then if all of those moths survive to reproduce, in only two generations, we've now created a population that has three times more dark moths than we have light-colored moths. And so just this random chance could suddenly cause what we call genetic drift in the population. Now we're going to come to the fourth and final way that evolution happens. This is probably the best known, which is called natural selection. And now we're going to see why I originally chose to have light-colored and dark-colored moths as this example, because we're going to go through one of Charles Darwin's most famous observations. So Darwin was famous for observing a specific species in London called the peppered moth, or the pepper moth, and originally it looked kind of like this. It was sort of grayish white in color. And one of the things that was great about having this moth be exactly this color is that it blended in with a certain kind of tree bark that was very common in London at the time. So here is the pepper moth against the bark of a tree, and I had to make it big so you could actually see it, but the pepper moth is right here, and then this is its head right here. But you can see that it's extremely difficult to see the pepper moth, and unless you knew it was there, it would be very difficult to see it, especially from far away. Every once in a while there'd be a mutation, and a dark-colored pepper moth would be produced just by random chance. So you can see that this pepper moth would stand out pretty significantly against the light-colored bark of the trees, and so it probably wouldn't survive long enough to reproduce. Okay, so I've made myself a little table here, and it's important to put this into context in terms of time and place. So in the year 1811, it's really, really uncommon to see these dark-colored pepper moths because they stand out so vividly against the light-colored bark of the trees that they would almost certainly be eaten by predators. And so maybe a few would survive long enough to reproduce, but they would have to be extremely lucky. Whereas with the light-colored pepper moths, they would blend in almost perfectly against the bark of the trees, and so almost all of them would survive long enough to reproduce because they wouldn't be eaten. So now we fast forward about almost 40 years. And we're going to take a new survey in the year 1848. So take a minute and think about what sort of things were going on in this time gap right here, so between the early 1800s and the mid-1800s. So if anybody thought of some of the inventions that were invented during that time gap, we can think about things like the first steam-powered locomotive, but also the rise of machines. And for the first time, machines were employed to make parts for other machines. And at this time, the only form of power known was either water power, but increasingly coal power. So the Londoners were burning lots of coal to keep their houses warm, but now also using coal to do things like run factories and run locomotives. And coal produces a huge amount of soot and a huge amount of smog. And so during this time period, between 1811 and 1848, the trees of London got pretty gross and pretty covered in soot and smog. And so now, instead of having these light-colored tree bark, we had trees with really dark bark and really dark leaves. So now, the light-colored moths would show up very clearly against the bark of the dark, soot-covered trees, and so it was very rare to have any of them survive long enough to reproduce, whereas suddenly it became extremely advantageous to be these darker-colored moths right here. And so over just a few generations of moths between 1811 and 1848, suddenly there were almost no light-colored pepper moths anymore, and now almost all of them were dark-colored. This is an example of what we call natural selection, and the phrase natural selection wasn't actually used until much later, but this is the first recorded case where somebody observed this happening. Now remember, the moths themselves are not changing color. A light-colored moth doesn't suddenly decide to become a dark-colored moth. We're just seeing the number of dark-colored moths increase relative to the total population. So earlier on, we would only have seen a small percentage of the moths be dark-colored, whereas later on, we would see a large percentage of the moths being dark-colored. So let's go back to this idea of evolution for a minute. Remember that this is gradual change in a population, not change in individuals. And it's going to work by virtue of these four different mechanisms: mutation, migration, genetic drift, and natural selection. One of the final things that's really important to remember about evolution is the idea of descent with modification. So it's all well and good to know what evolution is, but it doesn't help us a whole lot if we don't understand what it means for us. So let's look at this tree for a minute. Down here where this dot is a common ancestor for all of these individual organisms. So fish, and lampreys, and reptiles, and mammals, they all at one point did have a common ancestor. However, at one point, you had a small modification that occurred, which caused the invention of the vertebral column, so when the organism started to have a backbone. And then from there, we invented things like jaws, and walking legs, and having eggs, and having hair. All of those were invented by mistake. They weren't something that was invented purposely. However, it allowed for the organisms to survive in a different way, and maybe to survive a little bit longer, and ultimately those organisms formed their own species. However, even though now turtles cannot mate with leopards and are a totally different species, some things are actually really interesting if you look at the skeleton of these organisms. If you look up here, we can see that we have what are called homologous structures. So you're probably pretty familiar with the structure of your own arm. Your humerus, your ulna, your radius, your carpals, your metacarpals, your phalanges. But if you look at the bat, the whale, and the cat, you can see that they actually have very similar structures. Even something like a whale that doesn't actually have fingers that it manipulates still has finger-like bones, and whales actually have wrist bones, because whales and humans have a common ancestor way, 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 way back. If you look at something like a bat, you can see that the bat also has those same finger-like structures. Even though it doesn't use them in the same way, it's a small, modified structure that looks a lot like human fingers. And that's because if you look way back down here, over at this column right here, you can see that we actually had a common ancestor way back when. So finally, you can also see that we all start off looking very similar. So here's the lamprey over here, which you also saw in the chart earlier. And then you also see things like chickens and cats and bats and humans. And we all look very similar up until the middle of our development when we start to see recognizable structures. That's it for now. Make sure you bring your questions to class.